I know we have some people that are out there at the smokehouse, and we want to get out there later, but I'm not going to wait for them to come in.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
God bless you. We welcome you here to the Word of Life Christian Church. And we say, as where the Word is alive and lives are changed. And that's why we're here this evening, because we believe that lives are going to be changed with some of the leadership and work that is going on through the mayor's office and through her administration. And we're so thankful that you're here today to voice concerns and voice ideas and thoughts and get answers to your questions and continue to move forward. I would ask that everyone would go and vote. I know if you're here, you're going to vote. But take those that may not go out and vote. Amen?
Yeah.
You can put your hands together. We clap here. So you're welcome. And thank God for your presence today. And we look forward to having a very enthusiastic, energetic town hall meeting on this evening. Thank God for all of you. Let us bow our word of prayer. Father God, we thank you for this day and for all the many blessings you have bestowed upon us. Your word tells us this, that this is the day that you have made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And then, Lord, you tell us in your word to be anxious for nothing.
Yeah.
But through prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let our requests be known unto you. Lord, our request is that this city would return and even be better than what it would ever have been before. Lord, we pray for great leadership, great strength and courage from our mayor and from her administration. We thank you for all that they're doing. We thank you for the strength, the courage, and the character which they are sharing with this community. And we pray right now that as they go forth, even tonight, to bring forth the answers to questions, that you would guide, direct, and continue to lead them with integrity and with purpose. Now, Lord, we ask that you would just let this be a meeting that is productive, fruitful, and viable to the future of this city. We love you, we thank you, and it's in Jesus' name that we ask it all. Let us all say amen.
Yes.
Amen. God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you for opening up your church for us, too. We really, really appreciate it. I do want everybody to see the City of Flint staff. Bruder is our chief financial officer. You may not know his name, but I guess you can tell by the uniform. He's our chief of police, Tim Johnson. We have Steve Branch, who is the chief of staff. And I'm sure you can tell who this man is too, our fire chief, Ray Barton. City Administrator Sylvester Jones. And we have Suzanne here with Planning and Development, Suzanne Wolcott, and Kristen. Kristen is our Public Relations Director. And you see the rest of our city of Flint's finest, as we like to call them. We also have, I do see one of our city council members here, Councilwoman Van Buren. Let everybody see you. Thank you for coming. You all can have a seat. This was going to be. I passed the move. I see my pastor here. This was going to be a different town hall meeting that we're having today. A lot of it, we do want to go outside and see some of the things that are outside, because really we're here to talk about public safety today. There are a couple of things that I do want to talk with you about before we move outside to talk about just what's going on out there. And Pastor Wilkerson, you started off when we were really talking about the importance of voting. It's election time, and we want people to make sure they get out and vote. If you have voted, take some people to the polls. It's really important. There's more on the ballot. We know we've got the presidential election going on, but we've got a lot of issues on the ballot for the city of Flint. And that's one of them is the public safety millage. I know there's something for what else, parks and recreation. But there's judges are on there, school board is on there, my trustee is on there. There's a whole lot that's impacting the city of Flint. So please make sure you go to the polls and vote. Go early or make sure you go next Tuesday. So I did want to say that to you. Also, we do have information, and I think, Maxine, do you have this information? Because the Office of the City Clerk has extended hours, and so I want everybody to know that. And I think you have those that you can pass out to make sure everybody has those. Right now, the City Clerk's office is open 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. Monday through Friday, and Saturday, October 29th from 8 to 3, and then again, November 5th. Well, if you miss October 29th, November 5th from 8 to 2. So we have extended hours, but I want her to pass that information. So you'll have it, and if you don't need it, give it to somebody else. And we also have all of the City of Flint voting locations. We have that information for you as well. So in case you don't have that, if you don't know where you have to go, we have that information for you as well. I want to give an update too. I got one of these questions when I came in. Somebody was asking me about the lead service line replacement and when were we coming to, you know, to your neighborhood. And while I don't have all of that information in front of me, I don't know if you all saw the press conference that we had yesterday, but it gave some information about the crews have started back working. And we're trying to get about 800 homes finished before the winter season. We have $25 million, so it won't all be spent, but we want to get at least 800 of them done before the winter hits us and we have to stop. And so I want to let people know where we're doing those lead service line replacements. Right now, we have three different areas where we're doing them. One is on Copeland Boulevard and Bagot Street between Forest Hill Avenue and Valley Highway. That's one section. The next section is on Oklahoma Avenue and Dakota between Lewis and Door Highway. That's the second section that we're working on. Over here in the Ninth Ward, we're working on Campbell Street, Leland, Crawford, Albert, Clinton between Fenton Road and Grand Travelers. So that's where we are over in this neck of the woods. But one of the things that you need to know is that there are two things we're asking you to do. One, you have to do if you want to get the lead service lines replaced. There's going to be a consent form or a permission slip going around. And really, I want to pass that around so people can see it. If you don't sign this, you will not get your lead service lines, you know, get those replaced. We have to have your permission to do it. And that form that's coming around will be, they're really door hangers. That's just a copy. but that's what has to get filled out in order for you to get new pipes. We have to. And if it's a rental property, I think the tenant has to sign it as well as the landlord. We have to get two signatures. So please make sure you do that, and if you don't, notify us so you can get that. Yes? They're going out now. People are going out now. We have volunteers that are doing that, and if they missed you, if you were not at home when they came by, then the contractors will be coming with those permission forms for you to sign. So that's the first one. The second one we have is we still need to continue to test and monitor the water. So I think, is it Wednesday that's coming around? And they'll be asking for permission because we want to do a pre and post testing of the water because that's how we'll know if we're making the progress that we need to make. So it's two things that we're asking people to sign. One is to get new lead service lines, and one is for us to test the water before and after. And please remember, if they're coming to your neighborhood to do the lines, we need you to flush before for 15 minutes at least, and we need you to flush afterwards for at least 15 minutes. But all of that information will be given to you, but just as a reminder, you have to do that. You have to do that. So one of the things that Kristen, you can help me out here, I know we said we would be putting the information on the website. It's on the website. Okay, at cityofflint.com. If you can't remember and you want to look it up, you can go to cityofflint.com. And then each week we'll be putting that updated information out so people can see when they're coming or where they're coming. But it is on our website because I know I told one lady I did not want to give her the wrong information. I know we're coming, but I just couldn't tell her when. But that's another way to find out. So that's what we have on that lead service line replacement. Did I miss anything? Okay. One more thing that I wanted to touch on before we start really talking about public safety is I got a question about the commercial. There was a notice sent out about commercial properties and water deals. And so what I've said to people is we did send those out. We had about, I think it was a list of maybe 13 places, commercial places, and in some cases they were tenants, where the water bills had not been paid in a total close to $1 million. And actually, we have one person on there listed four times that owes us over $500,000. And what we have talked about is, you know, people have asked me, are people going to be evicted because of they were tenants? And my problem with it was, we don't want to evict anybody. That is not what we're trying to do. That's the last resort. And we were being proactive when we contacted the Salvation Army and other organizations in case that happened. Our issue is people have paid their rent, and the water was included in the rent. And so the landlords got it, and then we in turn have asked them to, if nothing else, we've asked people to at least pay the sewer portion of their bills, to please pay the sewer portion. They got the money for that, and they did not send that money to the city of Flint, and we need that. One of the things that I've always talked about is not paying for something that was being used. And now, you know, and that's a fight that, you know, as soon as I got in, I took on with the governor to really negotiate us getting the 65%. We all agreed that we could use the water to flush our toilets. Everybody said, I use it to flush my toilet. That's sewer. We need to have that sewer. Yes, sir. Okay, let me finish what I'm saying first, and then we'll get, because that's real detail. I need people to pay the sewer portion, and that's what we've asked, because everybody agreed we use the water to flush our toilets. Some of the other things we've agreed that people use their water for was if you watered your grass, if you washed your car, if you washed your clothes or shower. So we said, yeah, we agree we use that percentage of the water. And I think that was where the 35% came in. Is that correct, Mr. Sahuda? And so that's why we're being asked to pay for the portion that you use. But we have said, please pay the sewer bill. And the reason is, well, there are a couple of reasons. One is we need money coming into the city. Because if we don't have any money, we might as well go back to the emergency manager. Because we won't have the finances to run the city. That's one of the problems. The other thing is, it's going to be winter. And people are going to say, how come there's no salt on my street? Well, if I don't have money to buy salt, you can't get salt. And so that helps us with those kinds of expenses. It helps us purchase the salt that we need. It helps us purchase the gas for the police cars and fire trucks that we need. It helps us when we have to pay consumers for those light bills. And so that's why we need some of that money coming into the city. And so that's why we have asked people to please pay that portion of it. The other reason we put that information out there as far as the landlords is because we want the tenants and people to hold them responsible. People shouldn't pay their bill and the landlord keep it and not pay, you know, if I'm paying you for my water, then the landlord needs to pay that portion of it. They shouldn't just be able to keep that money. And that's what's happening. You know, the other thing we know is I have a home that I use a boiler in order for me to heat my home. So you need water to do that. And so we have to agree that we use it for that. And so we have churches, we have schools, we have commercial buildings that use the water for those kinds of things. And so that's why we were asking you to pay that portion. There's another example is Hallwood Plaza. The tenants have paid their money, they've paid their rent, but we haven't gotten the water portion or the sewer portion from Hallwood Plaza. So there are people on the list. And what we did was we just listed what the top, I think, was it 12 or 13 were, that really amounted to about $1 million that the city is looking for. And so while I want everybody to know, I don't want to put anybody out. We were just being proactive. And I would rather take those landlords and those businesses to court to get the money than to put people out. So I just wanted to be real clear on that. If my chief public health advisor was here, she'd also say the other reason we don't want to turn water off is because we already have health issues going on. And that would be a real public health disaster for that to happen. So that's not what we're trying to do at all. And maybe that would be something that we cover at our next town hall with our chief public health advisor to talk about what's going on public health-wise. She couldn't be with us this evening. So I just wanted to put that out there on the table. Now you, sir, have a very detailed question that I'm not going to stand here and answer, but it doesn't mean we're not going to get an answer tonight. What I'd really rather do is have you talk with Mr. Sabuda, who is over that area, and he can give you a better answer than me standing up here trying to respond to that. So it's not that we're not going to get your question answered. But now I want to talk about, one of the big reasons we're here is public safety. And I have been telling people I'm just so proud to stand up here between these two men that are leading our police department and our fire department. They took on some real challenges, and it's been under their leadership that we've been able to make some good things happen in the city of Flint. You know, if we didn't have this water crisis, public safety would be the number one issue. That would be the number one issue in the city of Flint, because we've always been high. They talk about how we've been the murder capital, the rape capital, the violent crime capital. Everybody talks about all the fires that we have and the arsons that we have. And under, you know, having these two at the helm has really turned those numbers around. And we're just really excited. I know I am thankful to have them here. And okay, Chief, I'm going to say it this time, and I'm going to get it right here. I told them, I said, there are two things I'm not going to do as mayor, and it's jump in fires and jump in front of bullets, because I'm scared to do that. But I am so happy that, you know, there are other people that are braver than me, that we have to do that. Because it takes a special person to go to a job every day and you don't know if you're coming home. I don't have it. And we need people that do that. And one of the things we've been tired of, I know I have been, is people using our police department and our fire department as training ground. That's what seems to happen. Because we have had such bad statistics. People come here and get trained, And then they can go someplace else and make a lot more money. And then we have to start all over again. And that's draining. It's draining financially, and it's draining, you know, mentally and physically for the people that are in those departments. And so we're talking about this public safety millage that's coming up. We want your support. I know I do. I know they deserve our support because these are the people that are keeping us safe day in and day out. And so we need to support them any way we can. You know, I wish we could pay them. They deserve to be paid more. I had two chiefs that really have pay cuts, but they took the job anyway, and they're turning things around. So if that's something that we can do, is really pay them what they deserve to be paid, we need to be able to keep the resources and supports that are in place right now. People have asked me, well, what about that last public safety millage? We don't know what happened to the money. People said that we were going to get more fire, we were going to get more police, and that didn't happen. And I can't be responsible for that. What I can be responsible for is what happens with the money now. And that's what we're all agreeing to do. We want to let people know, and so that's why I'm telling you right now, is to keep what we have. Because that's what we have to do, is keep them. You know, I'm gonna let them get up and talk, because I'm gonna sit down, but it's interesting. The other day it was Devil's Night, and I went to the fire station. I was at the main fire. Well, I went to one fire station, and before I could really start talking with them, they got a call, and they had to go. So then we went to the main fire station, and when I walked in, I was kind of excited because I said, wow, you guys are ready. It was really impressive because they had boots and everything put on your head, and they had their jackets, and everything was ready in case that alarm went off. But it was a strange feeling because when you look at the jackets, it had their names on it. And I stood there and I said, wow, look at you. I said, you all are ready. I am so impressed. But then as I looked at those names, I said, I hope all of those names come home tonight. And so it was a real eerie kind of feeling. And that's what happens when the police officers go and the firefighters go. And so I really just want to stress the importance of us getting this public safety millage passed, because we need them, and we need to give them what they need to do their jobs. So having said that, I know we have something outside that we want people to go and have a look at. And I know there's some information. I don't know if these okay, I want everybody to get one because that gives you the information that you need about public safety knowledge. So, Chief, can I take one more first? Because when you come up, I think you want to go out for people to see what's going on. Okay, so I'm going to have
good afternoon, everybody. We are short. Numbers are small. I think when I started the department, we had 400 officers. We're down around about just at 100, and only 50 of them are actually all on the streets right now. But the rest of them are just providing justice and other things like that. But let me say this. It is important as well as get back. We don't want to lose any of the officers or the resources that we have at the present time. We can't afford to lose one officer down there. I think when I first took office, I was ambitious, and the city kind of gave me a different attitude a little bit, but I was under the mindset that I was going to go in there and I was going to do some things, and we were going to do some things and make some things change and better for the city. And I tell you, I'm not really feeling real great right now because I'm not happy with the numbers in the city. I was hoping we would hit at least a 50% reduction in crime, and then we had a spike last week or the last 2 weeks, and we had about 6 or 7 homicides within October alone. And we were down somewhere around about, I think we were at 22nd, and last year we had about maybe close to 40 something, and this last week just right up in the 30 something, and it blew my mind, to be honest with you. resources that we do have. I pray to God we don't lose any of those resources, because if we do, you're going to see, thinking of getting some service before we went out to the office where they were holding 40, 50 calls, and now we're not holding any calls. I don't know if you guys know that or not, but we're not. What do you mean? Before we were holding 40, 50 calls, when a citizen called in, they were, their calls was not being answered. It was depending on the nature of the call, because they put on hold until they had somebody to send. That means when the next shift started, they were down to 40 to 50 calls before they even got their patrol cars to start the shift. Well, there was some recent restructuring done in the police department. I told the lieutenants and captains that don't send them off the phone. And then actually I got the call down to about 6 to 12. But then I told them, don't send them off the phone. If they got calls on their board, that's very important before they go home. Okay, so that means non-citizens ain't waiting anymore for calls to answer the service. And the officer wasn't happy with it at first. You know, they kind of, said, I have things to do. You know what they said. So, make a long story short, it really didn't matter. They didn't go home. And now they're coming into work and they're starting with zero calls, all pending, and they're happy about that. So now they can come in if they got to use the restroom, if they got whatever they got to do, they can get it done before they just jump right out there and start answering calls. 40 calls down, not the calls that's coming on top of the 40 calls are down. The 40 calls are down, they're trying to clear those out before they take on new calls. That's not happening anymore. The 911 call center actually called and told one of the captains, I don't know what you guys are doing, but you need to keep going. This is working. And that was about 2 weeks ago. When I first took office, we were number five, the number fifth city in the nation to live in. They considered, Clinton being the worst place to live. We're now at number 18. We're not even in the top 10 anymore. And we're going to keep on pushing. We're going to keep on pushing, and I'm going to keep on riding, and we're going to keep on restructuring until we get it right. But I will say this, I cannot do it without you guys. I can't do it. It's not going to get done without you guys' support. Without that notice passing, it's going to take us back until I figure out how to restructure some more and get them and pull us back out of it. It's going to hurt. It's going to hurt. We can't afford to lose one officer. So I really, truly pray that you guys can ask your family members that can vote, come out and vote, especially in the presidential race, but more so where it affects us home and our public safety. But both areas is extremely important at this day and time in our country. Myself and the fire chief, the job's not an easy one, and I know I'm not going to talk for one, it's really not, but God didn't put me here to fail. So I'm going to stand on his word, and a lot of people ask me, well, how are you going to do this and how are you going to do that? I'm trusting God to take me through it. He brought me to it, he's going to take me through it. So I'm not worried about it, but I do need your support. And I appreciate the support you guys have given us, because we've had some outpouring support from the community. In light of all the police shootings, citizens coming up saying thank you for your service. And I'm talking about pretty much everybody. Flint, I didn't feel the pain like a lot of other cities felt in Flint when I was out on the streets. I didn't feel that from our citizens. There was a lot of respect. There was a lot of thank yous. There was a lot of that stuff going out. And I didn't agree with a lot of the shootings. Let me say that out front. You guys saw what happened. You saw it for yourself. Unless the cameras were right into us, it didn't look right. And that's one thing we need to stop doing. And that's hiding behind that blue coat of armor, or whatever they want to call it. If they're wrong, they're wrong. That's the bottom line. But I appreciate your support. I appreciate the support you guys have given us with this reserve unit that we've been trying to put together. We are putting together. It's actually an operation without current support from the citizens from the community in Flint. And we appreciate that. We appreciate everything you do for us. So we're going to keep on doing the best we can do to service you guys and give you the best public safety we can give you. Thank you. The primary target team, it was a team of officers that I put together to combat the crime in the city. It was part of my restructuring phase. When I first came into office, we didn't have a proactive unit out there. This team of officers have done just that. They were put in the operation to be proactive. And I can't tell you the number of guns within the last 5-6 months. It's pretty close to over 100 and something guns. A lot of fully automatic weapons. It was totally automatic. The It was well over $100,000 in money confiscated, went to the city, and I can't even tell you the number of arrests. That cat squad, those eight officers in the cat squad, to be honest with you, when you compared them to the patrol numbers, and I was getting out of patrol, it was almost like 3-1. You know, but these guys, understand this, these guys were putting in a lot of their own time. They were not getting paid for a lot of time. They came into the department, so I'm pulling them, I'm stretching them, I can see a burnout coming. Let me put it like that. You can only pull somebody so far before they start getting burnt out. And these guys are pretty much around the clock. When I call them, I can get in my bed at 3 o'clock in the morning because I'm getting those calls at 2 and 3 and 4 in the morning. And I mean every day almost from citizens in Flint. And when they complain about something, I pick up the phone and I don't call about the 911. I pick up the phone and I call the guys in the cat squad and I say, and I ask them, and I know there are some of them at home and they're sleeping and just like I am, and I send them back out there anyway. You know, and some of the times, I don't see overtime slips from them because they're not paying them overtime. You know, there's no overtime to be paid. So they're volunteering the time, you know. And for the cat squad officers in the back of the room, let me say I appreciate you guys. That's three of them. There's no disrespect to the other police officers, but when I say Kent's finest, you're looking at them right back there. There's three of them right back there, and I truly mean that from the bottom of my heart. They love this city about as much as I do. They were out today, and they were out passing out literature on their time, passing out literature as far as this village, and it wasn't just those three. It was all eight of them, and it was some other patrol officers that was off duty that came and helped pass out literature also, because this is very important for us and for you guys as citizens, because we don't want to lose our services. It would provide you guys, and I appreciate you guys. Love you guys. Thank you.
I see a couple of people. I do want to say hello to our state representative, Neely. And I do want to just point out Harold over there, who's been working. Harold, good to see you. Who's been working with the plumbers and the pipe fitters and the saying they could be part of something bigger when they were paying the National Guard to come and distribute water. So we said we could pay them to distribute water, package food, but we could do even better than that. We could hook them up with the plumbers and the pipe fitters and put them in an apprenticeship program so they could get paid and have a really great skill, a great job to be able to take care of themselves and their families. And Harold is helping us make that happen, so I just wanted to say thank you. I think we're going to have Chief Martin come up here next. And there are the firefighters. I want all the firefighters and the police officers to just really stand up so we can give you all.
Continue to try to provide you guys with the best services they can.
Microphone, please.
Black on white, white on white, individuals being shot. We've had individuals in our community, like I said, we're taking a lot of guns off the street. We had some of the cats brought off the bus to get in front of, but they was chasing guys down, guns was pulled, and they couldn't act, they couldn't shot them, they couldn't shot them, and it would have been clear today, it's bad there. But they did, and they could have got shot for not shooting first, but they chased them down, and the guy was throwing, and took the guns off of them. That's what happened in this city, that's why we had to have a police officer shoot. I had to mention that because it goes to show that their character, because they could have shot, and it would have been under the national light like everybody else. Matter of fact, we just had a police officer just the other day, he was a regular patrol officer. It was a call that went out, there was a guy standing on the corner with a gun. They pull up, sure enough, the guy can see the gun in his waistband. The police get out of the car, and one officer by himself, one of our canine officers, he told the kid to drop the gun, and he told the kid not to move. The kid reaches in his waistband, pulls the gun out, could have been shot at that point because he got his hands on the gun. He tells him to drop it, he drops it, and the gun hits the ground, and he goes up, and it's a 14-year-old kid. The gun is fake. It looks as real as sure as the one we carry. Fake, it looks, I mean, just that real. And he said, man, he said, my finger was on the trigger. And I tell you, it was there to pull. And he said something just kept telling me not to do it, not to do it.
Wow.
And I think, I mean, it's that kind of self-control. Attitude and mentality, that's what we want all about. We want all of our police officers to respond. We don't want them second guessing themselves, but we do want them to use caution and not be so fast to pull that trigger and give somebody a chance, even though they could have shot, to give them a chance to lower the weapon.
Yes.
Good afternoon. I'm here for the fire department, as the chief of the fire department. Let you know, it's public safety. It's something back in Kentucky, I mean, is, when I hired the fire department back in 87, we had 287 firefighters in 10 stations. It was the time, we used to call in overtime, and we dropped below 48 people. Right now, I have probably 56 firefighters from the whole state. And our firefighters back there, the one thing about the fire department, it's a team. So it's not me as the chief, it's a team. I'm the coach, I call the plays. They go out and do what we need to do to get it done. And with the fire, our guys are constantly, we have three people on the truck, and I can tell you scenarios where they pull up to a fire, they say somebody's in there, and these guys got three people on the truck, and you send it. And so when you got three people on the truck, you got an officer, a driver, and a firefighter. Of course, the driver's responsibility is to make sure they got water. The officer is supposed to be out there to direct everybody coming in. But if they say somebody is in this house, the officer and that drive and the firefighter will go in, and the officer will ask the next truck coming in to assume command. So that means you have two people going in to search a resident that they've never been in for a while, a person, and one person standing outside, they gotta make sure they got one. So now if something happens in this house, you got one person to go in and get out, more than two, because they only went in because they was told somebody was in there. I'm saying we've had incidents, you know, with babies, and that's so hard. And, when you go in the body, going in fire destroys everything. And all of a sudden people start, we have to be careful what we're going out. And somebody said, wait a minute, that was a baby. So now you got to stop and watch. And the firefighter find the bodies, get ready to toss in front of the buildings and die. And we gotta go back to the station and deal with these things. I'm saying, if you're going in the house and you don't know, Station 1, which is that's who is back there today, Station 1 right now is protecting everything on the south side of town. So when they pull up in the structure, just like my first couple of months in Vermillion, they got a house fire. Three kids. We're in. They go in, other crews arrive, but they go in here searching for a house. Three kids, they find two bodies upstairs. They say it's another kid. And you go, they find a third kid. Then they didn't know at the time the fire was going on. So put the bumpers in there now. But all that time you're searching for a house, you got three people there, maybe four, but you only two of y'all inside, searching to the structure to find the fire. They go in and they do this every time. I'm saying when we get the fires, they go in and they do it. And times have changed so much, because I used to always ride with the police and I could tell them. Back in the day, I used to say, half the police would go through their careers and never pull out their guns, being the fear of their life. But if you work for the fire department, you go in the fire. I'm saying, we do things for recovering bodies. And things happen for this reason, you don't even know why it's here. But just public safety, you know, is just so big, because we have the ability to hire 33 people under a safety grant. 33 people would put 4 people on my fire trucks. It would open Station 8 back up. And that would be so big because it would increase in time. But if this public safety doesn't pass, and with that 33, the federal government is going to pay. These firefighters are going to pay their salaries and benefits for 2 years. And like again, I got 50, my total staffing, including administration, is 65 people. They're going to give me 33 people to pay their benefits and their salaries for 2 years at no cost to the city of Flint. And so I'll be working the station, putting 4 man pumps and doing all this. But if this safety, if this public safety goes to God, $2,700 to outfit a firefighter with bumper pants, the jacket, the hood, the helmet, the gloves, and everything you need to fight these fires. We need the extra SCBAs. Our SCBA's lifespan is supposed to be about 10 years. Currently, we have 33 SCBAs, and that's self-contained breathing apparatus. That's the actual protective building that. We have 33 of them that have been purchased in 2004, about 9 of them right in operations. We have another 15 that was purchased in 2007. About 7 of those are in operation because we have so many fire. And so they already expire next year. So every tank we have next year would have been the big expiration date or exceeds. And so the public safety will help equip these firefighters and we do all those things. So it is so important. You can't expect people to run in and risk their lives. And the crazy thing is about this thing is our firefighters are going in and doing this. The law states that they can go in without having the right amount of people on the scene. It doesn't say they have to. Even at a normal family structure, single family structure with out of basement, they say you should have at least 15 people when you pull up to the scene before you actually go in the house. We only staff 14 people a day on most days. So when they're pulling up to these fires and they're going in these fires, they're going in because we know sometimes this is the homes, things that people have, that's all they got. One thing you want to protect is your family, and you want to protect your belongings. And it's weird because we get cars every day, and we'll be going out here shortly, and we have a fire safety house that we go and teach kids. And we go to school, and kids send cars. And I'm in the bring some of the cars that they wrote. But last week I received a car, and the car was like, firefighters do more than save lives. They save homes, they save dreams, they save everything. And when I thought about that, I said, that's so true. Because when you have this picture of your grandmother, I lost my mother 11 years ago, so my house burned down. I could possibly lose every picture that I have with my mother. Those things you can't get back. And so we went, and they constantly going in risking to save your property, to save your life. And we just saying, we need y'all's support so we can continue to do that. I'm saying, it's so good. But when the kids say that, I said, oh my God, the kids do it. And then over the last week, and people watched on 12, I had a young boy that had 2 brain surgeries. And the teacher or somebody asked him, what did he want? He said he wanted to meet me. I'm like, really? He wanted to meet me. And I was like, and his mother was like, yeah, he wanted to meet me. I said, so we got to do more than that. It can't be about him just meeting me. So yesterday morning, after being up there all night, my firefighters got to give them credit. Because even though it was slow, they still was up at 2 in the morning. Their last fire together happened at 2 in the morning. They got back to the station about 5:30. But again, I showed up at the station at 7 o'clock. It was all cleaned up, ready to go. We went to the young man's house and we surprised him and all that and tell him. Last week ago, we gave a ride to the station, a ride to school, we all walked to school with him, took pictures with him in his classroom. But I'm like, how can the kids get it in the adults? I'm saying, so the kids understand that we say the Lord is just lied. We say that we're giving people the future. The adults should get it. If they get it, I know they'll vote yes on this much. And so I'm looking forward to this book is passing. I know it's going to pass because I believe in the people in the city of Flint. I'm from this city. That's why I'm still here. I'm not going to abandon the city. So I believe in you all. I hope you get this thing together. Thank you. Like I said, we do have a fire safety house in the back. And we would just like y'all to take a look. You're going to have to spend a lot of time in. But it's a house that's structured, so it's so. It's set up so we can teach kids to provide kitchen safety. He has a bathroom, has a small bedroom upstairs. So we teach them how, when you wake up at night, you should open your eyes first when you get that smoke alarm going off. If you see the smoke, don't just sit up, because the smoke and heat is actually what kills you. And that's why that gear is so important in public safety. We're in an environment that can get over 1,000 degrees. We walk in environments where your health is well, light bulbs and all, getting everything like that. The smoke is toxic in itself. And these day and age, with the styrofoam, everything is not wood construction and paper anymore. These things produce cyanide fumes that you can die just by inhaling with the chemicals. So that's why we need the phrase piece of the SEA. So we teach the kids, open your eyes first. If you don't, you look up, you see smoke, roll to the bed. And then you teach them to crawl to the door, touch it with the back of your hand. If it's hot, don't go out. And the smoke coming under the door, stuff something to prevent that smoke and go see your way. If you're scared to jump, wait. And for adults, the average adult is 5'4", whatever. But if you hang from the window instead of just jumping, if you're on the second floor, you hang, you look down, make sure it's clear, let go and drop. You might twist your ankle. It's better than diving out the window. So we teach them things like that. We teach them about not putting foil in the microwave. We teach them about going on and getting a safe place to meet your family. And that's what this smoke house is about. But not only for kids, we can teach adults a lot of things too. And we do so much more than just put out fires. We educate the public on fire safety. We develop evacuation plans. We teach them first aid. We teach them CPR. We teach AED. We do so much. Our firefighters are dual certified. Every fire department, firefighter in the fire department, not only are they a firefighter, they are EMT or a paramedic. So that means first responder means we knew we were going to get there before the ambulance. So if they have a heart attack, and I tell people all the time, you live long enough, a firefighter is going to come to your house. If it's fall because I fall and they can't get up, that's true. We get those calls, we'll put somebody back in the bed. You get older, start having heart issues, you can't breathe. The diabetes, we go and we're going to check your blood sugar, we're going to put you on oxygen, and we're going to stay there until that ambulance gets there. And so it's so important, like I said, to support us, because we're going to do whatever we can. Again, the house is about to be like, you all to take a look and see what we offer. Like I said, we offer so much more. I'm not going to say it. People call the fire department and talk to people and all over the world to tell them all the things you really want. So, again, thank you.
I want people to go out and see what they have out there. I think you said not more than how many at a time?
10.
At a time, okay. I know Suzanne wants to say something about the parks, don't you? But I do see that our council president came in here now, so thank you for being here. I appreciate you. I see Councilman Megan's just walked in as well, so thank you. I have three of our city council here, so thank you very much for coming.
Thank you, Megan. Good evening, everyone. In addition to the two public safety millages, there's a parks millage on the ballot for next week, and I'm encouraging everyone to go out. I believe that everyone received a brochure that was passed around. This is it unfolded, but I think you have a trifold brochure, and it explains and provides a little bit more information on the city's parks. But I wanted to give you just some background before you head on out to the smokehouse on the city's park, so you can understand why we're requesting your support on the village. And there's a lot, I think, that people don't know that is going on in the parks. Parks is actually handled through the City of Flint's Planning and Development Department. And it is It is a much smaller department than many of you, I think, would realize. As recently as 6 years ago, the department, it was a department, it's actually now a division within the Planning and Development Department, but as recently as 6 years ago, there were 30 employees in parks, and it was parks and recreation and forestry and golf, and I think most of you remember that. It's much different now, and it exists by virtue of the Parks Millage, period. That is the source of funding for the Parks Division in Parks and Recreation, and so it's critical that that continues. And it's also important to know that this is a renewal. It's not a request for additional funding. It's a renewal. And I wanted to let you know a little bit about, so in the city of Flint, we have over 1,800 acres of parkland. 1,800 acres, which is made up of 70 parks and public recreation areas, 3 active community centers, which includes mini parks and play lots and neighborhood parks and parklets and trails, which most of you have heard of. We currently exceed the National Recreation and Parks Association of 10 acres per 1,000 residents by over 90%. Which is really helpful when you're looking for open space, you're looking for quality of life. The parks actually help your quality of life, they help your health, they provide great benefits to the residents of the city of Flint. So what this millage will actually cost to the average taxpayer, it's approximately, home to the taxable value of $25,000, can expect to pay $12.50 a year. That's just a little over $1 a month. If your home is $50,000, you can expect to pay $25 a year, a little over $2 a month. That's not much to ask for the open space and recreation and quality of life issues in the city of Flint. The Parks Millage is the city's only dedicated source of funds for parks and community centers. So what the Park Millage actually does is it leverages a very small city staff that we use. We've gone from 30 employees back in 2006 to 0.75. 0.75 people in the Parks Division. And what they do, we've been very creative. Planning and development, many people don't even know what planning and development does. But the department handles parks and recreation, it handles planning, zoning. Most of you have heard about the Imagine Flint Master Plan. That's a huge priority that lays out the framework for how the city spends its money, how it allocates its land, the usage of the land. We handle community and economic development. So parks is a component of the planning and development department. And what that 0.75 leverages is a 0.5 staff person, so half a person's time, who is very creative and develops and works to create partnerships with many of your neighborhood groups, your block clubs, your neighborhood associations, other community partners across the city, so that we can take care of those over 70 parks in the city of Flint. Currently, we're working on over $2 million of grant-funded activities in parks. The partnerships have added physical improvements to our parks, as well as provided additional mowing services or reduced utility costs. And I think that's important because many people complain about the quality of the parks, about mowing in the parks. And when you think about the dollars that are actually available for parks, the millage is about $314,000 citywide for 70 parks. That's nothing really when you think about it. So these partnerships actually leverage these arrangements with other community groups to provide mowing services. So as there are needs for mowing in parks and you feel that something is not being maintained, you can make that call. If you have a group, if you're aware of a community group that's willing to help adopt a park, to work with the city, to create a partnership, to mow that park, that's what this person does. Adam Moore, he's not here tonight, he couldn't be here, but he's been out speaking all across the city on the Parks Village. And he is, when you call the Parks Division, you will reach Adam. Adam is the person who is assigned, and he will work with you. If you have a group that you would like to help volunteer, help adopt a park, he will work with you to help establish a relationship to take care of that park. If you don't, if you have a complaint, he will also work to help resolve that complaint. So I will give you that number because I know that there are many instances where there are issues in the parks, and we work very hard as a team, as a department, to resolve those issues. The number is 766-7426, and he is extension 3029. And it's also on this brochure that you have. So when you read this brochure, it will provide you more information on parks. And I know that everybody is really interested in getting out to the smokehouse. So I'm going to close for right now. I just wanted to say, give you a couple ideas on specific parks improvements that have occurred over the past year. Many of you have heard about the Grand Traverse Greenway Trail. McKinley Park has had improvements. Kersley Park has had improvements. The community centers have had improvements as well. And completed by the City of Flint since 2015, Genesee Valley Trail, Riverbank Park, which is an ongoing project, Max Brandon Park, the whole facilities at Max Brandon Park is ongoing, Brennan Park, phases 1 and 2, and Dewey and Foss Avenue Pavilions. That's work that's all coordinated through Planning and Development Parks Division. And I encourage you all to come out and vote next week and support the city's park village.
I know they are waiting on people to come out to look at the smokehouse and see what we have going out there. I'm not sure where. There was a man here that had a question for Mr. Sabula. He said he's going to hang back in case anybody wants to talk with him. Okay. He's going to hang back here in case anybody has questions for him as far as what we were talking about with water. But otherwise, I think they're ready for people to start coming on out there to see what the firefighters have.